You're listening to A Word from the Lord. A Word from the Lord is the weekly podcast of Bethlehem Baptist Church here in Paul's Valley, Oklahoma. We are located at 311 North Dunbar. And before you visit us in the service, we will have to wait because of the coronavirus situation. We can't have more than 10 people within our service, so I have to invite you to join us in Cyber Church. Visit our website at www.heargodsword@bethlehem.com. Again, it's www.heargodsword@bethlehem.com. And at is spelled out at atbethlehem.com. And go there and click our Facebook tab and join us in Cyber Church. Every Sunday at around 11:30, we will have our Cyber Church service. We'd love for you to join us there in our Facebook Live broadcast of the Word of God. That's Sunday at 11:30 and Wednesdays at 6 p.m. We're staying connected to the body of Christ through Cyber Church. So visit us once again. www.heargodsword@bethlehem.com. We are living, people, in an uncertain time. And in this uncertain time, I believe that God has a word for you. God has enabled me to put out 4 books in the Hang in There series as we're trying to encourage saints all across the nation and all across the world. And if God is speaking to you, you pick up this book. The first book is entitled Hang in There, and that's just a book for those who need encouragement. The second book is Hang in There, Pastor. And right now we can't have churches in many of our states because of the quarantine. It's a most stressful time for pastors, and God has sent me over these airwaves to say, hang in there, pastor. Not only that, but Christians can't go to church. And as a result of that, it's very stressful upon the Christians as they go through times and trials of life. The third book is entitled, Hang in There, Christian. God has a word for you, Christian, to hang in there. And this last book in this series is Hang in There, Coronavirus Survivors. Because this is the most stressful time. Many of us have been hit in metropolitan areas with this coronavirus, not only in the United States, but all over the world. God has a word of encouragement for you. So we want you to hang in there. Buy the books at my Amazon page. That's amazon.com/Rev. Dr. Michael E. Ton. That's E-A-T-O-N. Again, get either of these books at my Amazon page at Reverend Dr. Michael E. Ton. That's amazon.com/author/Rev. Dr. Dr. Michael Eaton, E-A-T-O-N. Once you get to my page there, you have to scroll to the right to get to these newer books. We want to encourage you. We want to challenge you during these stressful times. God says you can make it through. Hang in there. Hang in there, Pastor. Hang in there, Christian. Hang in there. Coronavirus survivors. Now, without any further ado, let's get into the Word.
Praise the Lord. We want to thank you for that devotion. And before we get started tonight, we want to welcome those who are tuning in to us live or in the rebroadcast of the live service. I am Michael E. Ton, the senior pastor of the Bethlehem Baptist Church here in Pauls Valley, Oklahoma. 311 North Dunbar is where we want to see you. If you don't have a church home, we'd love to see you in the service after all this is over. The corona issues have caused us not to be able to worship the way we would love to worship, and we do miss those who we hadn't seen in a while, but through God's help, we're going to get through such a time as this. So if you are listening, and I see for the first time, I don't know how to really do this, but if you know what you're doing, you can see who's tuning in, but I see Herman Jackson up there, so I don't know if I'll see you any other time, but I do see Herman tuning in live, and we appreciate you tuning in. We thank all the members who have been participating from a distance like they've asked us to. And we're just going to make it through a time such as this. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Before we get into the word today, always like to have a few announcements. What are we, church?
Bethlehem Strong.
Ooh, that sounds good. What does that mean, church?
His strength is perfect in our weakness.
Amen, and praise the Lord. And that was a theme that actually Sister Denise came up with during the church anniversary. Amen. And boy, did we need this thing for this year, because if you do not have the Lord on your side to be your strength in this time of weakness, you're not making it at all. Amen. Amen. Want to thank those who fasted and prayed this last Friday, and I'm going to continue to ask us to fast and pray every Friday until we move from this period of time in the life of our church and city, town, and state. But we thank you for fasting and praying on Friday. There are two levels of this, fasting and praying from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., to which we're going to be doing this Friday, on Fasting Friday. And the second level is for the prayer warriors, is that we want you to fast and pray from 7 a.m. on that Friday to Saturday, 7 a.m. So we will be doing this until we go back to normal. Amen?
Amen.
So we're going to be fasting and praying on Fasting Friday, April the 11th, and for the prayer warriors, 8th to the 11th through the 12th. And again, we thank you for fasting and praying. We had to fast and pray this Friday, and we were fasting and praying for Sister Jay, and praise the Lord. Last I heard, she was on her way back home, so we praise the Lord for that, and we were fasting and praying for her. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And fasting and praying for all those families who have had losses. I forgot to mention Brian Fazell and his family, and I do have up on this Facebook page several families who have lost loved ones, and it's been very difficult in regards to funeralization. We had a preacher friend of ours, Reverend Josie, who passed, and during this time, you can't collect more than 10 people together. So it's been very difficult for families who have lost. So I've been encouraging people to go to the links I have on my site there and to drop a note to the family. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And I've been saying my 12th anniversary, the first Sunday in May, we're going to try to get through it. We're going to try to pull it off. I don't know if it's going to happen, but... But I do know that this date is 2 weeks after our 21-day, what the governor asked us to do. So it's 2 weeks after that. So we're going to see if we can go ahead and pull that through. And if not, we're going to celebrate anyhow. Amen and praise the Lord. And talking about celebrating anyhow, can anybody tell me what Sunday this is?
Palm Sunday.
This is Palm Sunday. So I want you to be encouraged, because some of us, boy, it's going to be hard for us to get through Easter Sunday, not like we usually do. So, yeah, we got to find a way where we can kind of celebrate. Like Sister Eton said, maybe take pictures of you dressed up and post them on your page and because we're going to celebrate anyhow. We got to find a way to celebrate anyhow. Amen? Amen. Amen. So I'm still excited about Easter Sunday. And let's not let these issues cause us not to be excited. And on my site, there's a 7 last words I put on my site where I'll probably post that the Friday where you can go and listen to the 7 last words from the cross. The COVID, I always get this thing wrong. COVID-19 is it, what, how you say it? Coronavirus, the coronavirus report. I like to give this report because we are here in Paul's Valley, Oklahoma, and a lot of people are panicking here in Paul's Valley, Oklahoma, like we're in New York. New York has lost over 2,600 folk who have died from this virus. And we get the national news here, and a lot of time people are reacting as if we are in a place like New York. So I like to give the numbers just to kind of put people at peace. In-state, our numbers are we have had 1,159 cases in-state, and we've had 1,362 negative people who have who thought they had it and didn't. It came back negative, 316 hospitalized, and 42 deaths in the state of Oklahoma. The state of Oklahoma has 3.9 million people. So we've had 42 deaths. And I like to let you know the ages of this. Those who were 65 plus, 31 in the state of Oklahoma. 31 died who was 65 plus, 50 plus, 9, and 36 to 49. So I always like to say that because we've been saying that those who are older are more susceptible to dying from this. So dying from this, and I've said this before from the pulpit, that this thing is like trying to battle the invisible man, because there are some, particularly young people, who have it and show no symptoms or have minor symptoms, and they keep going, keep working, keep doing what they do, but they come in contact with somebody who is maybe have diabetes or some other issues, and for people like that, that's wonderful. I see Sister Jones joined us, Audrey Jones joined us. Boy, I'm getting good at this. Amen. Jocelyn's there on that page. Amen. So we thank you guys for tuning in, We always encourage you now. We have a lot of folk in our church who are hit this rank, this age, and some of these conditions. So we encourage you to do what the doctors have been saying. Wash your hands. Wash your hands. I should have been saying wash your hands thoroughly. Amen. Thoroughly, not just a little phony little washing. Thoroughly wash your hands. And we challenge you to keep your distance. Keep your distance. And especially, and as the governor said, he said that if you're elderly and you have these kind of conditions, you should really kind of quarantine yourself and be away. And that's why they're locking down nursing homes and people's such as that. Because, again, I could have it and don't know I have it. And I go and visit somebody I love and they are already somewhat sick, and then I pass it to them. So that's what makes this thing so tough, but we're going to beat it. We're going to beat it in Jesus' name. As I said before, the hot spots are our most populated area, and that's probably why New York is dealing with they. Do they have 8 million people? We have 3.9 in the state. They have 8 million in like little square blocks, miles there, like from Manhattan to Brooklyn, just really close proximity of one another. So, Cleveland County, which at Norman. They've had 169 cases and 8 deaths. And I had to go to Cleveland County last week, and I was thinking, wait a minute, Cleveland County ain't like Paul Valley. So, because they've had some deaths there. And Oklahoma County, I think, well, they got 221. And then the other one is Tulsa County. If I knew what I was looking at, Tulsa County, what is Tulsa County? Anyway, Tulsa County has a lot, too. I can't find them right now. But what we're looking at is Garvin County. Garvin County, now we have, I gave the wrong numbers on Wednesday night because I was looking at the wrong thing. I was looking at the deaths. We have 0 deaths in Garvin County, but we do have 11 cases now as of yesterday morning. So we have to continue to be vigilant and do the right thing and so that this will not spread. But we do believe that God is able in all of this. Amen.
Amen.
God is able and he's going to enable us to make it through. We just have to be wise as we're always wise. Like in flu season, you know, yeah, you don't come close to nobody got the flu, do you? At least I didn't. I tried to keep them away. Any other kind of sickness, like coughing, like Maury's doing right now. Just merely, brother. But, you know, we've always done distancing. You should have always been doing it. So, once again, don't be discouraged. God is in control. God is in control, and he's going to enable us to make it through a time like this. And remember, we're in Paul's Valley. We're not in New York. We've had no deaths. I pray to God we won't ever have any deaths.
But that's
the report there. Amen?
Amen.
This little video I'm going to show is how church is getting through this time. And they put together it's going to play about a minute. They put together what do they call it? Choir, a cyber choir. And after that, we'll get into the word. My books, I've been telling folk about this to encourage people. They're online. You can get it at the links up there. But this is the cyber choir. Look at them. All in different places. Amen. Praise the Lord. I wish I could say you got to go online. I'm going to have to post it. But it's a church out of Huntsville, Alabama. It wasn't Jerry Young's church. But that's just to show you how they're creative and they worship. And that's what we have to be. So I'm challenging Bethlehem's choir. Nah, we can't do that. We don't have that technology. we can't? Well, hey, I'll put the challenge out there and see what happens. Is that Zoom? Sister Eton say that's Zoom, so we wanna okay, well, I'll put the challenge out there. Okay, we'll see. Hopefully we can get it together before Easter. We will see. God is able. Amen. But I'm going to go ahead and get into the message this morning. I've started a new series during this time, And this new series is called Choose Faith, Not Fear. Choose Faith, Not Fear. Faith over fear. We've been standing on Isaiah 41 verse 10. Isaiah 41 verse 10. And it says to fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed. No, that's down there. You can't see it. That's bad lighting. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. I've been encouraging the saints to memorize that during this time because we're going through detrimental times. But this morning, we're going to share in that series a message entitled A Providential Pandemic Quarantine. A Providential Pandemic Quarantine. And it is located in one of familiar texts, Psalms 91, verses 1 through 5. And we're going to read that together out loud at the same time on three. One, two, three.
Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at noon midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. That was the text that, a verse that brought me to this as we're in this pandemic time and as people seem to be dying all around us. The author of this psalm says, 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you.
Amen.
Amen. Now that's a pandemic verse you need to memorize. Hello, somebody. But we're going to talk about a providential pandemic quarantine, and we're going to see 3 points. We're going to talk about the shelter of God, the safety of God, and the shield of God. The shelter of God, the safety of God, and the shield of God. And we want Christians to know tonight that Christians should believe God can protect them from disease. Amen. Christians should believe that God can protect them from disease. And we're going to look at this brief video, and then we'll get into the Word.
He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation.
Amen.
Amen.
And praise the Lord. And as I was reading this text and that verse came to mind, I couldn't help but to think that this is a text that I needed to share on this Sunday morning. Because we are, as I said, I can't ignore the big pink elephant in the room. And the big pink elephant in the room is that small businesses have been shut down. Only companies that have been deemed as essential are still open today. I can't ignore the fact that our school systems have been closed down. I can't ignore the fact that there are folk who are at home and they're tired of being at home. Hello, somebody. I can't ignore the fact that they say that marriages are a lot of marriages are in trouble because they are stuck in the house. Hello, somebody. Children are getting on parents' nerves, and I've really been praying for the parents of children, because for this to happen unexpectedly and for it to go on for so long, that's a great burden and great trials, and many people are in so much stress. Many folk are healthy and can't go to work, have been sent home or laid off, and these are the times that we are going through, and I have been somewhat critical in how some of our leaders have been dealing with this situation, because I do believe that it should be dealt in a county by county way, as opposed to treating everybody like we're in New York.
Well,
hello, somebody. Well. Now, you've heard me say all throughout this time that we have to be wise now. We have to keep our distance, wise ahead, do everything the doctors are saying. But everybody is not in such a crisis mode. And there are folk who are concerned about how they're going to make it, because we have cut all them off at the feet. Hello, somebody. Oh, and some people have become critical and wondering whether or not this disease is throwing the baby off with the bath water, because there are so many folk who are suffering and they're not even sick. Hello, somebody.
Come on,
suffering and not even sick. And but it's because of fear. And I've been challenging us as a church and as a city, as a state, to fear not, because it's fear that causes us to act in ways that are not logical. And that's why folk got more toilet paper than they have food now. Hello, somebody. Because they are so afraid. They're so afraid of death. And Christians, I'm very surprised that Christians seem to be as afraid of death as anybody. Hello, somebody. But that's why I told tell us, don't fall asleep. Don't fall asleep on Sunday school. Stay woke on Sunday school, because Sunday school lesson tells us what happens when a Christian dies. It tells us how we live in eternity. It tells us and helps us get in a mindset that this world is not our home and that we are just passing through. But you've heard me say this all this time. Everybody want to get to heaven, but nobody want to what? Die to get there. Hello, somebody. Nobody want to die to get there. Everybody wants to live forever. And the experts have been telling us that the folk that have died the most are those who are over the age of 65. Hello, somebody. And I said, I believe it was Wednesday or Sunday, that the average age, they say, of an Anglo man is 76. And the average age of a black man now is supposed to be 75. I don't believe that one. But anyway. But the average age is set. So we have shut the world down for folk who are already at a high mortality rate, which means a lot of these folk have lived healthy lives and they're gone on, particularly Christians, have gone on on to heaven. Hello, somebody. But we are afraid and we shut our world down, shut all everything down. And God is looking, especially at Christians, like, and what? Hello, somebody. We forgot who God is. God says, and he's saying in this text today, in this message about a providential pandemic or quarantine, that God has you covered. You do not have to fear. God has you covered in this text. If you don't understand in this text, you won't ever understand how God have you covered. Hello, somebody. And the first thing we see is the shelter of God. The shelter of God. The shelter of God says, whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High, will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. Hello, somebody. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High God will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. And if God is close enough for you to be in his shadow, guess what? You don't have anything to worry about. You don't have anything to be concerned about if you're in the shadow of the Most High God. And I use this illustration many times about my Uncle Roy. My Uncle Roy would take he and his boys to the state fair, and I would go with them, and we would be walking. We were little boys back then. I forgot what grade, probably seventh, eighth grade, something like that. And boy, we was walking. We'd be walking bold out there at the state fair in Texas, bold. And he said, why were you walking bold, Reverend? Because we knew where the shadow lies. We knew that Uncle Roy was right there. I was in his shadow. And Uncle Roy was a big man. Hello, somebody. He was a big man. Hello, somebody. Yeah, big man. And I was a little boy. I was skinny back then. But because I was in the shadow of Uncle Roy, I know that if anything popped off, hello somebody, that if anything happened, I knew that Uncle Roy was going to take care of business. As a matter of fact, I was a little bit more bold when Uncle Roy was with me. Hello somebody. Yeah, you stepped on my foot. Hello, what? Because Uncle Roy was with me, and that's how we should be as Christians.
Amen.
In this time, in this uncertain time, we sit or we stand or we walk in the shadow of the Most High God. And if we sit, walk, stand in the shadow of the Most High God, then we can be bold at this time, and we can be confident at this time to know that God is with us. And because God is with us, then and what in the world can be against us in this old time or in this world? Hello, somebody. What can a virus do to me? Hello, somebody, that God can't protect me from. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. That's the God that we serve. That's the God we serve. He says he's a shelter. When you're in the shadow, he's a shelter. And when it's hot, some of y'all don't know what it's like being hot. I'm really meddling because most of y'all probably do. I don't know what it's like. Because some of y'all know about them fields. Hello, somebody. Some of y'all remember having church in the summer and we didn't have internal air conditioning. Hello, some had to raise the windows up and let that 100-degree wind flow through. Hello, somebody. Oh, but you know the importance on a hot day of shade. Hello, somebody. And shade could save your life. God says, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High God, that his shadow, his very shadow, because we are under his shadow, that means that he's our shelter. Hello, somebody. This text here, Psalms 27 and 5 says, for in the day of trouble, he will hide me in what? In his shelter. In the day of trouble, he will hide me in his shelter. Are we living in a time or in a day of trouble? And if you're living in a time and in a day of trouble, you better learn how now to run over to the shadow of the Most High God and to get the shelter that he offers in a time of trouble, in a time of uncertainty, in a time when you don't know how you're going to pay your rent, in a time where you're concerned about getting sick, in a time that they shut you out of schools, in a time now you got to be in line at Walmart, in a time they said last week that Ardmore Walmart didn't have any meat. Hell, somebody, in a time of trouble, you better learn to dwell in the shadow of the secret place of the Most High God. He says that I will shelter you in the day of trouble. He will hide me in his shelter. He will what? Conceal me under the what? The covering of his tent. Hello, somebody. And he will what? Set me high upon a rock. That means he's going to set me in a safe place. He's going to take care of my every need. Somebody, at the sound of my voice, is concerned about rent, concerned about car payments, concerned about light bills. You're concerned and you're frustrated because you wail and you want to work, but they won't let you come in to work. You're not deemed as essential, and they told you to stay home. But I'm so glad that God deems you as essential. I'm so glad that God's not saying stay home from heaven. I can't help you stay home from heaven. I only have a limited amount of resources. Get in line from heaven because I only got a little limited resource. Oh, I'm so glad that my God sees me as essential. And because I'm essential, he's going to take care of my every need. He's going to be my shelter. In a time of trouble, in Jesus' name. And I said, this virus done changed my preaching. I can't no longer say to your neighbor, oh, neighbor. So all I can say now is, look at your neighbor. You say, yeah, Reverend, I don't want nobody breathing on me. Look at your neighbor and think in your mind, neighbor. You know what the preacher's saying is true. Hello, somebody.
Amen.
Because he's preaching the word of God.
Amen.
Talking about a providential pandemic quarantine. A providential pandemic quarantine. Let's go to the first place. It said the God of shelter. And the second thing, it says it's the God of safety. The safety of God. The safety of God. Now, this is really what kind of blew my mind, because I said verse 7 is really what brought me to this text. But this is what blew my mind. It says here, surely. He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence.
Amen.
And I began to think back about some folk who in our congregation that farm. You know, think about Deacon Prince and Melvin's did some types of farming, and for me, I always thought of pestilence like either. What you put on the crops to keep the crops from, you know, from the insects from eating up the crops, the pestilence, that was pestilence every time I read this in the Bible. But I did a little research. Really, I really didn't do a research. It just fell out off the pages of scripture, I guess, in the Bibles and a study Bible. Sometimes that's why you need a study Bible to help you get a little deeper. But the study Bible showed that this deadly pestilence meant a deadly disease or virus. Hello, somebody. A deadly disease or virus. And when you look at that, especially in our day and time, it says, surely he will save you from the deadly disease or virus. I was like, hallelujah, he will save me. I don't have to be afraid. I don't have to worry.
in fear. God says, now he had told me that if 10,000 fall right next to me, that he was going to keep me, but he told me specifically in this verse, that coronavirus for the Christian, for that person that's fully saved, for that person that's fully committed, it says that God will keep you from the fowler snare and from the deadly disease or from the deadly virus. And I said, hallelujah, Lord, you're going to keep me. And really, God gave me a homework assignment. I had just found out what it meant. I just found out what it's meant. And then on Friday, on Thursday, instead of going to my study, I had to head to the hospital. And guess what? The hospital wasn't in Garvin County where I felt safe. Hello, somebody. Well, I feel safe in Garvin County. But I had to go up there to Cleveland County. Hello, somebody. That's right down from Oklahoma County, where for us is our epicenter. Hello, somebody. And I began to think on the way there, I'm like, oh, Lord. Now, Lord, now you know I got some issues already, Lord, so I might be in that realm of folk that are susceptible to getting it. Hello, somebody. And the Lord had me to see this. Oh, he said, Reverend, now, you're going to have to live this word, Reverend, now. You're going to have to believe what my word says. Oh, you talk bold when you preach. Oh, but let me send you to the epicenter. You talk bold. You preach bold. Online and on Facebook. But you ain't never really been tested yet. Now let me have you have to go to the epicenter. Let's see what you're gonna do. And you know what? I got in my car and I had to pray all the way there. Hello, somebody. But I made it. Hello, somebody. I had to pray all the way there, but I made it. Hello, somebody. And I said, Lord, I see you. Lord, I understand. Lord, you gave me another Sunday school lesson. Oh, you told me right before you dropped it, right, gave me a text from heaven that you can protect me from the deadly disease. And then about 10 minutes later, you sent me to the epicenter, to see if I understood what your words said. And then and only then can you stand up on Sunday morning and be able to preach this with authority, preach this with power, because you had to put my words to the test. And that's what we're going to have to do and have to be. You see, what sent me there was Christian love. I was concerned about somebody who was in our sanctuary, who was in the hospital, and Christian love sent me there. And God is saying, a lot of y'all have shut off your bowels of compassion because of this pandemic disease. You won't do nothing for nobody no more. You know you should be visiting the elder if you can, and taking them lunch or taking them dinner. You know you should be doing what I put on your mind to do, but now you're afraid because of this virus. And God says, that I can protect you. I'll keep you from the deadly pestilence. I'll keep you from the deadly disease. And when I send you somewhere, you better go in Jesus' name. Let me say that again. When I send you there, you better go in Jesus' name, even if they're afraid of you. Hello, somebody. I've had to ask it. I visited some members, and they looked at me like I was a ghost. And I kept my distance. I just came just to let you know we love you. We're thinking of you. And then I'm going to leave in Jesus' name. But it's not time to shed off the compassion of Christian love because you are afraid. It's not time to shed off the bowels of Christian compassion. because you think you're going to die. God says, oh, I have the power of life and death in my hands. Oh, God says, oh, that I'm the one that can keep you in Jesus'
Amen.
Name.
Amen. Thank you, Father.
I can keep you alive. And I can provide for you while you are alive. In Jesus' name.
Jesus. Thank you.
This is a time that I've heard everybody say, even some of the older people say, that they have never seen before. But as I've been saying through this series, we may not have seen this time before, but we've seen our God before.
Amen. Amen.
We've seen our God before, and he's kept you.
Yes, sir.
Hello, somebody, from the fowler's snare. Hello, somebody. He's kept you. Some of y'all don't know that you should have been dead from another deadly virus. Hello, somebody. But he kept you. He kept you. And he was telling me, now, preacher, I showed you my power back in January. Now you're scared. And what is this, April? God says that he's a keeper. Hello, somebody. Now, this is the prayer that we need to pray, ask that God would answer for us. In 1 Kings chapter 8, it's verse 37 through 39, but I'm going to look at mostly upon 38. It says, and this is Solomon's commitment to the temple, of the temple, when he had built the temple. This is what he was praying, and this is what I pray that we can do from this place called Bethlehem. And he said he prayed this prayer, whenever disaster or disease may come, and when a prayer of plague is made by another amongst your people Israel, bring awareness of the affliction of their own heart and the spreading out their hands towards this temple. And then he says this, then hear from heaven. He said, whenever, oh, there's a coronavirus that strikes the land. You see, this is not the first virus to strike. Hello, somebody. It's happened before, and it happened during Solomon times, so much so that he had to pray this prayer, ask God would hear prayers from the temple when these things hit, and when the disease or disaster of disease happened, when the plague hit, he said, hear our prayers from this place. And that's why God has us here in Garvin County, is that we might be able to live up to what Solomon said would happen in the temple. And you know what? Oh, when Jesus died, we celebrated Easter next Sunday. But let me tell you what happened on that Easter Sunday when Jesus had to die, and when he was raised again, when Jesus got up bright early Sunday morning with all power in his hands. Oh, what happened is the curtain split from top to bottom, which signified that we no longer needed a priest. And a little time later, he gave, in the book of Acts, the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit resides in where? It resides in us. So which means that we are now the temple that Solomon said that God would hear prayers from. And it's time for us, as the temple of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to intercede and to pray for our town, pray for our church, pray for our saints, pray for our country in Jesus' name, and ask that God would hear us, and that God would heal our land in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. It's time for us to pray. That's why we're doing Fasting Fridays. Don't sleep on Fasting Fridays. We need your help. If you want to see us get back to normal, we need your help. We need you to fast and pray. We need God to hear you from the temple that you are, to heal all our land, to hear our country. Oh, to protect our county. Oh, and even protect our mayor. Hello, somebody, of this county. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I need you to pray with me, church. Oh, and I don't have to put together $1 million ring of people that people are doing now. Calls and videos. All I need is Bethlehem. Hello, somebody, to get together with me. All I need, because all them other folk, they ain't praying for Garvin County. All them other folk, specifically anyway, all them other folk don't know the small businesses and the owners of those businesses who had to shut down. Oh, we can call them by name. Call our county, our city, our members by name. I need you to join me Friday to fast and pray for God's safety. His word says that he can keep us safe. So we're going to pray and stand on the words and have some boldness as we're in the shadow of the Most High God to be bold enough to still be the church, to still be concerned about those loved ones who have dealing with death and sickness, to still be concerned and bold enough to step out in faith when God says for us to do it at times.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord.
Why are you afraid? God has said this morning that he is your shelter.
Yes, sir.
God has said this morning specifically that he's your safety from literally the coronavirus.
Thank you, Lord.
Hello, somebody. Literally, that's the way I took it. Literally, he had to show me. Literally, you don't have to fear.
Amen.
You don't have to be afraid.
Amen.
A providential pandemic quarantine. Lastly, at least I keep us too long. And you say, preacher, you say that all the time. Don't be watching your clock. But it says a shield.
Amen.
The shield of God. In verse 4, this is verse 4. I'm not making this up. Verse 4, he said, he will cover you with his feathers. And under his wings, you will find refuge. Hello, somebody. And his faithfulness will be will be your what? Shield
and rampart.
Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. Now, he does this, and y'all been in my fictive Bible reading. He puts God in anthropomorphic terms, meaning in human terms. He breaks it down to where we can understand it as humans. And he says, he will cover you with his feathers. And under his wings, and he's been talking to us. He said we're in his shadow. Hello, somebody. Now he's talking about his wings.
Uh-huh.
And he said, you'll find refuge. Oh, and I'm just talking about shield here, but let me get into the refuge, because we in Oklahoma know what a refuge is, because it's about to be what? Tornado season. Oh, and in tornado season, there'll be times when the weatherman will tell you to take shelter. Hello, somebody. To get into your safe place. And there's some who has a refuge called a tornado shelter. And it's either in their garage or our Deacon Prince has one right outside his house. And when they hear about a tornado, they got to seek refuge. They got to run into the refuge. And the last tornado that hit in Norman, we thought that we were going to lose thousands of people. We thought, as I was praying, we thought because it was so detrimental. Oh, But after the night was over, we discovered that we didn't lose many lives, because most folk in Norman have a refuge, and they have that refuge right in their garage, and they took refuge, and when the tornado came, they ran to the refuge, and they were saved. And God is saying to the Christian folk, don't you know that I'll be your shelter? Don't you know that I'll be your safety? Don't you know that I'll be your refuge in Jesus' name? But you better learn to run into me. And if you don't have a prayer closet, you better find your prayer closet now. And you better learn to run into your safe place. Which call your refuge. And we'll call that a prayer closet in Jesus' name. You better find it. If it's not in your house, you better find it at the park. You better find your refuge, because you need God now more than you needed before. And many of you are getting fed up. Many of you are getting mad and angry and short-tempered and hard to deal with because of all this stress. And God said, you better run into me and put all this into me, not your wife, not your children, not your high blood pressure. Hello, sir. You better learn to run into me.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. Amen.
I didn't mean to preach that part of it, but I guess it had to be preached, the refuge.
Amen. Amen.
We're talking about a shield. Anybody ever known what it's like to be shot at, know what a shield is? Anybody who's ever been threatened, hello somebody, know what a shield is. Anybody that know anything about the Roman soldier, you know that the most important piece of their armor was what? Was their shield. Because if somebody was trying to stab them with a dagger, they'd raise up that shield. Stab them with a sword, they'd raise up that shield. If anybody was shooting arrows from a long place off, they'd raise up their shield, and the shield would catch the arrow, the shield would catch the sword, the shield would catch the dagger, the shield would protect you. And God says, I see that devil shooting them arrows at you, but I can be a shield. I see that devil trying to destroy you with his sword, but I can be a shield. I see that devil who may be even close to you. See, in order to use a dagger, you got to get close. And we're dealing with folk who trying to, who are close to us now, trying to get at us with a dagger. That dagger. Maybe your mate carrying that dagger. Hello, somebody. Hello, God says, I can be a shield from those that are coming at you from a distance. I can be a shield for those that are coming at you. Close up. I can be a shield. It says, and his faithfulness will be your shield and your rampart. His faithfulness will be your shield. And I'm so glad. That God can be a shield, because we're getting it long distance, because the national government is telling us what to do. The state government from a distance, hello somebody, one day he'll tell us we're doing good, the next day he'll tell us we're doing bad. Hello, sir. You got arrows coming from the net, arrows coming from the face. Hello somebody, you got naysayers maybe in your own family. You got to say to all of them, the devil is a lie. I'm going to make it through this pandemic time. I'm going to make it. Corona's not going to kill me. And guess what? It's not going to destroy me. It's not going to destroy my church. It's not going to destroy my marriage. It's not going to destroy my children. It's not going to destroy my neighborhood, my school district, my city, in Jesus' name. Because I'm taking authority over all of it, because God is my shield. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. God is my shield. And I'm taking authority over this. Oh, the devil wants to see the left hand of Bethlehem put out. He wants to see us close our doors. Oh, and he's done everything. He's come at us for the last 4 years. Oh, like he had never had probably in the history of our church. But the devil is a lie in Jesus' name. We're going to make it through this pandemic time. We're going to make it in Jesus' name. And we're going to have faith. And we're going to walk in victory. We're going to walk in authority. And if we do have to get out, we won't fear in Jesus' name. Because God says he can protect me even when I have to go in Walmart. I was thinking now, if it closed down. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody, because it's the only place that's not closed down. Hello, somebody. It's where everybody's going. Hello, somebody. If there was a place, and you should be a big concern going there, and many have been. Hello, somebody. But God says, I can protect you. Oh, in Walmart. And God says to this man who's a man of war, I can protect you. Oh, on the battlefield, 10,000 folk may die at your side, but I am God and I can keep you. And I want you to know, Bethlehem, I want you to know those who are in the service and those that are out. Even if we had 10,000 folk, we're not even big as 10,000, that were dying on our right and dying on our left, God says, oh, that you don't have to worry. God says that you don't have to threat. God says, oh, that you're dwelling in the shadow of the Most High God, and I will protect you. I will be your shield. I will be your safety. I will be, oh, your shelter in a time of storm. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We won't be afraid. As a matter of fact, all things are going to work together for our good, because we love him and we're called according to his purpose. And I'm believing, oh, that through this, we're going to grow yet still more in Jesus' name. That God is going to use this time. We've been praying in this place for revival, that God would add disciples to our church. And I'm believing that this is our time, that this is our moment. Oh, to spread, oh, the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, church. In Jesus' name. We serve a God. Oh, that speaks to our every need. He told me specifically, I knew, but he told me specifically in this verse.
Thank you, Lord.
Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. Share this last secondary verse, and this is the anthropomorphic terms about how we're under his wings. And Ruth knew what it was like to come under some wings. And Boaz said this after she had proposed to him. Hello, somebody. He said, may the Lord repay your works, and may you receive a rich reward from the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have taken refuge. Hello, somebody.
Amen.
That's what I'm going to pray now. They say that in crisis, the word crisis means a time of trouble and an opportunity. And they said, while some people, when the stock market crashed, those who kept their head got rich and didn't panic. And I'm praying that that's what's going to happen to our church and the members of our church.
Amen.
Because we listen to the voice of God and we keep our head
and we don't panic,
amen,
that we see the opportunity that God is putting before us,
yes,
to
Lord,
take advantage of.
Yes,
and this is what this man who was rich, he prayed this prayer. He said, may the Lord repay your works. Because there's some folk at Bethlehem that has been faithful and still being faithful. Oh, some, have showed up here, and some, have come during the week, and they were faithful in their giving. And we know that when you're faithful in your giving, God opens the floodgates of heaven. And my testimony is that many times when you give to God, it seemed like, that nothing's really happening. You're just going through the motion. And my testimony last week was, the week before that was, one time in my life, I got in trouble. And when I got in trouble and I got in a crisis, I needed money that I didn't have. And when I got in that crisis, money began to come from everywhere like no other time in my life. In that crisis, provided for me, and I'm praying for those who've been faithful in Bethlehem, those who've been faithful, I'm praying that God will repay your works and that you will receive a rich reward from the Lord in this time of crisis, that God will cause revenue to come from many different places in Jesus' name. I'm praying that God would call down revenue from many different places, that he opened the floodgates of heaven and let it rain in your life. In Jesus' name, let it rain. I'm praying that you get that $1,000 check from the government, but yes, still more, I'm praying that your small business owners will get that loan that you can get from the government. Go to my page and apply for it, but I'm praying that God would give you still more, because you've been faithful, because you haven't panicked, because you did come when God told you to come, and you did go when God told you to go. I'm praying God's blessing down upon you, because you sought refuge under the wings of God. I said you sought refuge under the wings of God. You stood on his word, which said, they that wait upon and knew their strength. Another anthropomorphic term. And what will you do? You'll mount up with wings as eagles. And you sought shelter under the wings of the Almighty God. And I pray that he will bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. He would take this crisis and make it an opportunity.
Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord.
If you sell books, I'm praying your books. If you paint pictures, I'm praying that your paint pictures sell. If you have a lawn bin, I'm praying that God will bless your lawn bin. That he will bless you in what you do. And if you're deemed essential, that the company will know and recognize that you're even more essential than they thought you were. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
God would bless you in a mighty way, that you'll get a raise in Jesus' name. I'm essential, and I'm doing a lot more work. What you paying me? In Jesus' name, that God would bless you. I'm going to end us in a word of prayer. All eyes closed, heads bowed. And before I pray this prayer of blessing, I want to make sure, because that may be somebody, even as we've always said in the sanctuary, that there may be somebody who are here listening at the sound of my voice that do not know the pardoning of your sins. That do not know how to come into a personal relationship with God, because this word that I preach is for Christians, for those who are living holy and sanctified and righteous. This what that word is for. And if you are here today and you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior,
then this word really is not for you. As a matter of fact, if you don't know God, then you probably should be panicking. If you don't know God, you probably should be afraid because you don't have these wings, this shelter, this safety, this shield. You probably should have high blood pressure now and be about to stroke out. If you don't know him, you probably should be mean to your wife and your kids because you don't have no help. Because you've been laid off. But God has sent me here this morning that you might be able to get right with him. And in order to do that, you have to know that Jesus Christ was God's only son. And the Bible said that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And if you're here today and you feel a tugging at your heart, you may not understand what's going on, but you feel a tugging of your heart. God says this morning that you got to believe that Jesus died for your sins, was buried and raised again on the third day. Easter is what we're going to celebrate next week. That's what Easter is all about. It's about God who loved the world and who wants to save the world, not just from the coronavirus, but want to save your soul from the sin virus. And you, what you have to do is you have to give your life to Jesus Christ. You have to pray a simple prayer like this: Dear Lord Jesus, please come into my heart and come into my life as my Lord and Savior. I accept you today as the penalty for my sins and as the bridge to God. And if you can pray a simple prayer like that in Jesus' name, amen. If you can pray that simple prayer, then today you can be saved. And we want you to be saved. Maybe God shut down. Literally seemed like he shut down heaven and earth for this moment, for you to be right where you are, and for us to be right where we are and doing what we're doing, so that you can get your life right with God. And we're praying that you will. And if you prayed that prayer, we want to see you. When all this is over, we want to see you at 311 North Dunbar here in Paul's Valley, Oklahoma. 311 North Dunbar. We want to see you in the sanctuary. When all this is over, when the governor lifts what he lifts and our city folk lift what they lift, we want to see you in the service. Amen. Amen. Right now, I want to do a special prayer. And I'm not going to ask you to come forward because I want you to kind of keep your distance. I want to be truthful to the ordinances of the things of our land.
Amen. Amen.
But I want you to bow your heads right now, and I want you to pray. And if you're able, even get to your knees if you're able. But God can hear you from whatever position you take. He can hear you. And I want to pray this special prayer that I just talked about upon your life. Shall we pray? Father God, we come today. First of all, wanting to thank you and to praise your holy name, Father. For Father, you're truly worthy to be praised. We glorify you, Father, even though we can't collectively come together like we used to glorify you. We'll glorify you right where we are, Father, in Jesus' name. You are worthy to be praised. You are worthy even in a time like this. Well, we're suffering a bit. Oh, you're worthy to be praised. We glorify you and still believe that you're seated on the throne. And all power and authority on heaven and earth belongs to you, Father. And we want to praise your holy name. We lift you up, Father, in Jesus' name. And Father God, right now I want to pray a special prayer for those that are at the sound of my voice and those that are here in the sanctuary, Father. I want to pray, Father, this blessing upon them, Father, in Jesus' name, Father, because after you told us, Lord, about what you can do for us, that you can be our shelter, you can be our safety, you can be our shield, even after you told us that you were a refuge, Father, and after you told us, you talked about the wings, that we're under your wings, and we saw how Sister Ruth came under the wings of the Almighty God of Israel, and we serve that same God, and we come this Sunday stand to sit, to pray in the wings of God. And we're praying, Father, that you will reward us in this time of crisis, which means trouble and opportunity at the same time, in places in the world. And Father, we're going through trouble, but we're believing by faith at the same time there's an opportunity, Father, that you're going to present before us, and that you have presented before us, Father, that you're going to open the windows of heaven, Father, and that you're going to let it rain, Father, in our church. You're going to open the windows of heaven and let it rain, Father, in our households, in our marriage, in our family, Lord, in our church, in our town, in our city, in Jesus' name. When the devil is trying to destroy folks financially, Father, I pray, Lord, that you bless them financially in Jesus' name. For the devil is trying to steal, kill, and destroy. But the devil is a lie in Jesus' name. The devil is a lie, oh Lord, for every member of our church, or every disciple who worships here. Oh, the devil is a lie. Oh Lord, put him under your wings and provide for them, Father, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, we pray, Lord, for multiple sources of income, Father, in Jesus' name, in this crisis time. Bless, Father. Because we believe who you are. We believe, Lord, in this time, in this pandemic time, that you're still on the cattle on a thousand hills, in Jesus' name. And we're asking you, Father, Lord, to sell, to kill, to sacrifice, some of those cattle, to provide for your children's every need, Father, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And even those who are still working, we pray, Lord, you bless them yet still more. Bless them, Father, for hazard pay. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And in this crisis, Father, we look for the opportunities that you present. And we believe that you're going to present us with these opportunities. In Jesus' name. Amen. And praise the Lord. Amen. We want to thank you for coming here this morning. We pray your heart was encouraged. And remember, to online, those who are looking, visit our website, www.heargodswordatbethlehem.com. Click that Facebook tab. It'll put you to all of Facebook and announcements that we're doing and everything that's coming up. Also, you can give online. We thank those who have been giving at our church. We praise the Lord for your faithfulness, and God's got to bless you. We're standing on his word. He's got to bless you financially, and he's got to protect you physically. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let me give this benediction. Father God, we thank you, we praise you, we glorify your holy name. As we pray, Lord, for years, put your hedge of protection around us. Keep us safe from all harm and danger until we meet again. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen. And pray.
Hello, this is Pastor Michael Eaton. I want to thank you for listening to the word today. And before we sign off, we want to take this opportunity to make sure that you're in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. You enter that relationship not because you grew up in church, because your mother went to church or your daddy was the deacon or the pastor. You enter into a personal relationship with God by the simple ABCs. First of all, you have to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. B, you have to believe that He's the Son of God and that He died for your sins and was buried and raised again on the third day. And C, you have to confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that He died and was buried and raised again on the third day. And if you can pray a simple prayer like, "Dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart and come into my life as my Lord and Savior. Thank you for dying for my sins. Please enter into my life. Amen." If you pray that prayer, or willing to pray that prayer for the first time, what you need to do is you need to find a church home. And you need to find a church that is a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching, Bible-living church. And at the end of the service, after the pastor preach, you need to go down and let him know that you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and that you need to be baptized. And he would be willing to baptize you into the body there where you are, if that's possible. Once again, I want to thank you. Visit our church website, www.heargodsword@bethlehem.com. Again, click the Facebook tab and you can stay in contact with the events as well as the word on this podcast. Always have links there.
Hello, this is Pastor Eton once again, and we want to thank you for joining us on Word from the Lord weekly podcast. And again, I want to share with you the four books in the Hang in There series that we are encouraging Christians in this uncertain time. The first book is entitled Hang in There, Encouragement for Those Who Need Hope. The next book in the series is Hang in There, Pastors. This is a book written for pastors who need hope. This is a very stressful time for pastors, a time like pastors have never seen before. So pick up a book for your pastor, Hang in There. And also, as a Christian, if you're going through, and we are all Christians are going through, pick up the book Hang in There, Christians, for Christians who need encouragement. The last book in this Hope series is Hang in There, Coronavirus Survivors. Hang in There, Coronavirus Survivors. We want to encourage you today to hang in there. Pick it up at my author's page at www.amazon.com/author/Reverend Dr. Michael Eton, that's R-E-V-D-R, Michael Eton, E-A-T-O-N. Again, it's www.amazon.com/author/Reverend, R-E-V, Dr. D-R, Michael Eton, E-A-T-O-N. And again, pick up the book for encouragement, and especially for your pastor. Hang in there, Pastor. We need you for such a time as this. Thank you for joining us today. And if you'd like to support our ministry, you can go to our website at www.heargodsword@bethlehem.com. Go down to the bottom, click the support tab, and we would appreciate your giving to this ministry for such a time as this. Thank you very much. May God bless you and keep you is my prayer.